Well, it feels a little odd to be so formal in introducing Brad and Danielle to read their accomplishments, because they're very good friends of mine. But the accomplishments are considerable. So Brad is an associate professor of and director of the National Marriage Project here at the University of Virginia. He studies marriage, fatherhood, parenting, religion. The author of Soft Patriarchs, New Men, How Christianity Shapes Fathers and Husbands. He's been published in American Sociological Review, Journal of Marriage and Family, The Wall Street Journal, Weekly Standard, First Things. He's had fellowships at Brookings, Princeton, Yale, also op-eds in New York Times, Los Angeles Times, Washington Post. He is a very, very special scholar in his ability to bring important work to a wider audience. Also, the two of them, and Danielle is a graduate of Columbia and UVA. She's worked as a teacher, an educational consultant, and founding executive director of the National Council for Teacher Quality. She's the mother of seven children. As you can see, she isn't finished yet. And this is an extraordinary couple, what they bring personally to their Catholic community and to serious students of all kinds. And Danielle is such a mother. I mean, she just has a way with knowing how to get seven kids do what they're supposed to do. So clearly so that all kinds of other women, including my daughter-in-law, I don't think I even told you this. My daughter-in-law, we all got sick. It couldn't happen. She says, I just want to follow her around all day. they are remarkable human beings and talented, gifted, and so helpful to our community. So you'll get a chance to get to know them now.
Well, our talk today is called Wandering Toward the Altar, Courtship and Marriage in Contemporary America. And we have to begin, though, with two caveats. The first caveat is that, like this doctor up on the screen, we're going to be giving you lots of good advice. And in the sort of spirit of true confession, we didn't take every piece of advice that we're giving you. And we still don't do everything that we're kind of recommending today. But sort of the broader point is that it's still true, it's still worth thinking about, even though we don't always follow what we teach here.
Right, and also in the interest of full disclosure, when we were going through our courtship, we were certainly no experts then either. We sort of muddled through, and in fact, like many churches, our church required us to take a standardized test when we got engaged to see how compatible we are. So when we took this test, it turned out we failed 5 out of the 6 domains. So I was panicking, of course, imagining having to call off the wedding, etc. But the pastor who married us said, because the one area that we scored very highly on was a shared faith and a high view of marriage, we really both understood the permanence and sanctity of marriage. He felt pretty confident that we could work through during our premarital counseling all the other issues that we probably just hadn't talked about, which was, finances, how to deal with in-laws, how to deal with friends of the opposite sex, things like that. So anyways, there's hope for you. If you feel like you're muddling through, you will be fine. We so far have been. So, yep.
So to begin here, what we'd like to point out by way of introduction is that parents, professors, and peers, not to mention the wider culture, encouraging adults today to focus on education and to focus on their vocational future, on their work. And they often neglect inadequate attention or inadequate focus on marriage and family life. So that kind of raises this basic question: how do education and work compare to marriage in predicting meaning, purpose, and happiness among adults? So the basic idea here is that in high school and in college, there's so much attention, devoted to these things, to education and to work. And there's really very little focus on relationships and on marriage. And, given that reality, what do we know empirically about how these different things lend meaning, purpose, and happiness to our lives? And so to kind of just look at this empirically, I analyzed data in the General Social Survey, the GSS, and what I found here, as this slide indicates up on the screen, is that looking just at marital status versus being in the top half of median income, 50,000 or more, and being college educated, that clearly you can see here that your marital status is much more predictive of your happiness in life than is your education or your income. And if we go beyond that to look at being happily married, you can see that being happily married is much, much more predictive of happiness compared to both education and income. So the bottom line here is that you can see that forming and sustaining a strong marriage, at least on this important outcome, is a lot more important than two of the things that occupy most of our attention for young adults in this culture, and that is, once again, education and work.
So the question we have is, how are we doing in preparing the next generation for one of the most important sources of meaning and happiness in life? And courtship is rarely discussed today, unless we're analyzing Jane Austen or George Eliot, or talking about how we wish someone would court us. In reality, though, our churches, colleges, universities, and the broader society have largely abandoned the task of organizing courtship. And by courtship, we mean the practice or the system of rules and practices that guide young people into marriage. So when it comes to courtship and dating, young men and women in the U.S. are often clueless and confused.
And of course, in our day and age, I think we have to ask, or we may be asked, you know, why is marriage the end of courtship? Why should that kind of be the focus? And basically, there are two reasons here. And the idea is that marriage is an institution that virtually every culture has used to ensure, number one, that kids get the material, the emotional, the social, and the spiritual support of both their mother and their father. And then secondly, that men and women can order their desires for emotional, sexual, social, and material care and cooperation. So sociologically speaking, marriage is about bonding and it's about babies, as our friend back there is reminding us. So that's why, you know, really we should think about courtship being oriented towards marriage.
Because there are few, if any, norms about courtship, we'd like to provide a general roadmap, a list of a few do's and don'ts, some of them more obvious perhaps than others. But under the list of do not attempt this, do not do this, would be cohabiting. And for each of these, we'll talk about them in turn. But cohabiting, putting off marriage intentionally, relying overly on chemistry. Another thing not to do would be to marry a stonewaller or a nagger. You probably can intuitively understand what those are, but we'll talk about it. Things that you should do, though, is look for someone who has a demonstrated history of commitment to friends, family, and then during the courtship process to you in particular and to the marriage of as an institution. Also, you're looking for a virtuous man or woman, a person of character. Another thing is looking for someone who merits the respect of your friends and family. And finally, looking for someone with whom you can share your faith is helpful.
Well, as some of you know, because you've been in my class here at UVA, I asked this question to my students about a third of the way through class. Would you want to do something that would increase your risk of divorce, conflict, and marital unhappiness? And surprisingly, there are very few takers. Very few people actually raise their hand and ask them if they'd like to pursue this course of action. And yet we know that cohabitation from the literature is associated with an increased risk of divorce, with less marital commitment, with more conflict in marriage, and with less happiness in marriage. So it's clearly the case that cohabitation does not supply the kind of preparation that many people think that it does when it comes to marriage. It's important for us to understand what are the mechanisms here. And there are four that are worth mentioning. One is that cohabitation is not institutionalized. You know, there's no kind of procession down the apartment hallway, you know, here comes the cohabiting partner to sort of inaugurate their relationship. They don't have a script from their family and their friends. that they can use, a set of norms to guide them that they can use, where they're all on the same page. And so what that can mean in practice is that oftentimes you have two people who have kind of different agendas when they're cohabiting. One person is trying to prepare for marriage, and one person may think it's a good way to save on rent. And once that reality becomes apparent to them, that can be a recipe for confusion and for conflict, which of course doesn't serve them well later on, either if they get married or move into a different marriage with someone else. The second point is that cohabiting relationships are much less stable, and unfortunately becoming more and more unstable every year that we kind of progress. And so what that means is a lot of people are being exposed to multiple relationships, which gives them a sense of easy come, easy go about relationships, and also can lead to a sense of disillusionment with relationships in married life. The third point is that they tend to foster a kind of consumer mindset, where you're kind of like, you know, you're kind of kicking the tires here to see if this person does it for you. You know, do they leave their, I don't know, their toothpaste in the sink? Do they leave their socks on the floor, whatever it might be? And if they do that, well, you're not going to get married to them. Of course, the problem with that mentality is if you bring that mentality into your marriage, it's just not going to work, because there are going to be plenty of times, I mean, for us it's been very rare, where your spouse and your spouse annoys you.
Talking about other people.
Disappoints you, infuriates you. But if you're just kind of looking at this through the lens of consumption, well, it's not gonna go the duration when you're married. And the fourth and final point is that Scott Stanley at the University of Denver is doing a lot of great work on this. And what he is finding is that there's kind of a sliding versus deciding phenomenon happening in a lot of relationships, where basically cohabiting couples are much more likely to slide first into cohabitation. You know, they're dating, hanging out a lot, they're spending weekends together, and they start to just move in with one another. And then they get the couch, and they get the TV, and they get whatever, the microwave. And before you know it, kind of their friends and family expect them to kind of make the next transition. And that transition, of course, is marriage. And so they slide into marriage. And they've never really had a deliberate conversation. They never had an opportunity, really, to think about whether or not they're supposed to be getting married. And they don't have the commitment, particularly from oftentimes the guy, that is really the key ingredient for a good marriage. So Scott Stanley has found that a lot of the problems associated with cohabitation prior to marriage is the fact that people are kind of just, they're sliding into one thing and into the next without being really deliberate about that. And that's not a good way to start a marriage.
And what Brad's describing is something that we've seen a lot with our friends. And you might think, well, I have no intention of cohabiting myself, but based on the statistics, someone in your family will, your friends will, you might, you don't, and we've been surprised by the number of people we know who have and who have experienced some of the things that Brad is describing. One of my really good college friends, I don't think she set out for this plan in her life, but she had lived with somebody during medical school, and that didn't work out. Lived with somebody during residency, and that didn't work out. And finally, met somebody, they moved in, and they did get married. What's been interesting is that a number of times when they've had problems in their marriage, things have come up, especially things related to their two careers, because the pattern previously was career first. You know, they got different placements after med school, so that's why that they broke up that time. They got different jobs after residency, that's why that union broke up that time. So now here they are, she's with somebody else and they're married, and when issues with their career come up, the pattern has been career first, marriage second, you know, this partnership second. And you can see the distrust and the suspicion that's there as a consequence of having kind of serially cohabited. So it's just something that we've witnessed, and then we try and help our friends through to see the difference of the married state. Another point about marriage, I'm not sure if this was really covered, but is that it can be, another point about cohabitation is that it can be an unnecessary or unwanted detour from the goal of actually getting married. And one example of this was, you know, a neighbor of ours who stopped by because she was looking to, trying to know if I had any friends who wanted to move in because her boyfriend had just moved out. And, you know, of course, sobs broke out. And it turned out they had been together for 4 years, living together. And they had some crisis discussion, and he finally said, I just don't think I'm ready for commitment. You know, and she's like, but we've been living together 4 years. So he probably knew that at year one, but they had never had that discussion. And it was, you know, by putting it off, he was able to put off having to make that decision, whether he had the commitment. And as she said, here I am, mid-30s, I'm starting all over again. So you can see the cohabitation, you know, puts in place habits that are not good for your marriage, and also, you know, perhaps puts you off the track that you want to be on. So those are just some other points to think about.
Now, one of the messages you get in the culture at large, I think, particularly the elite culture, is that you should basically postpone marriage until your late 20s and 30s. And we also know, too, that young adults are, as a consequence, getting married in their late 20s on average, and the folks who are college educated are actually getting married typically in their early 30s. So kind of the age at first marriage kind of continues to march upwards. And that's consistent with kind of the elite wisdom, that is that you focus, you know, your 20s basically on your education, your career, and also on having a good time, you know, doing this and doing that, et cetera. But what we'd like to suggest to you this morning is that getting married in your mid-20s is a pretty good time to do it, based upon some work that the late sociologist Norval Glenn has done at the University of Texas, where what they find basically is that both in terms of marital stability and in terms of marital quality, the best time to get married is in, you know, in mid-20s, you know, give or take, basically. And I think there are three points to make here. One is that folks are mature enough to move into marriage. We know, for instance, that cognitively, adults aren't fully developed until, you know, around 22-ish in terms of higher cognition and everything. So it probably is a physiological thing, but also just life experiences, of course. But the second point is that in terms of not being too old, that, you know, folks aren't too sort of settled in their ways. They're not kind of confirmed bachelors, confirmed bachelorettes who've acquired all these little ticks that are going to be hard to bring into a marriage. And then the third point, of course, is that if you get married in your mid-20s, you're less likely to have had opportunities to accumulate a sort of a record of having had multiple relationships that might, you know, cloud your marriage.
I've witnessed this somewhat firsthand. I know this is being recorded, but I'm fairly certain my brother will not be watching this. But he's a great guy. Got married around, I don't know, 35-ish. He was one of the classic cases of somebody with an extended adolescence. And by that, you know, he actually had a good job, but the adolescent part of it was he spent his 20s and early 30s spending money the kind of way you do as a, you know, a high school kid or a college kid, all your disposable income spent on all your hobbies. He had an incredible mountain bike collection, an incredible collection of Grateful Dead CDs, every single track of Sugar Magnolia ever produced. Japanese anime was something he got into. So you can imagine, here's somebody who he's used to just dropping money whenever he feels like, on whatever he feels like. And he said that now married with their first child, one of the real challenges has been to actually think as a unit, to think, instead of spending this money, maybe we need to save up for that down payment, save up for a baby crib, you know, think of all the things I could buy, all the gear I could buy. So he's, I mean, we kind of joke him about it, but he admits these are hard habits to break. So these are just one of the kind of consequences of spending, you know, not everyone can, you can't plan when you're going to get married. Definitely at 25 it'll happen, but you can be kind of pursuing something rather than just aimlessly putting it off. And, you know, and I think in his case, it didn't occur to him. You know, there's so much gear out there to buy. So that's just one example.
Another point to make, and all this stuff is commonsensical, but also things that we, you know, that we've seen over the course of our long lives that people don't really pay attention to. So the point here simply is that men and women who have nothing in common are often attracted physically to one another. And that sort of physical and romantic rush is powerful, but it's temporary. And it won't sustain folks through the inevitable challenges of married life. By contrast, we call homogamy in sociology, which is basically a fancy word for having similar interests and values that can sustain a marital friendship. Homogamy is one of the best predictors of marital happiness and marital stability. So what we just want to encourage you here to do is to think about not just whether or not you're attracted to someone, but whether you have the basis in your relationship for a long-term friendship that will sustain you when you're old and wrinkly on your front porch, you know, in your 70s, in your home.
Or you have seven kids and you're in your 40s. So it is good to have, yes, homogamy. Finally, under the warning signs that we had alluded to, for men especially, one of those is to avoid stonewalling. So this is even something to look for during your courtship process. Men have a greater tendency towards this. And by stonewalling, I mean the tendency to retreat in the face of conflict or challenges and requests. I don't think this is an uncommon tendency among men to want to put off that difficult discussion. But the, well, I mean, you're unusual, yeah. But what you're looking for is somebody who can actually, even if they don't want to talk about it in the moment, can come out of their cave and work through some of the challenges that you're encountering. And then women.
The issue here is nagging, you know, of saying things or saying things in a manner that is fundamentally disrespectful. And undercuts a person's self-regard or a man's self-regard is often the case. You know, saying things like "you never" or "you always" or just even the tone. That kind of comment is not really constructive, obviously. And if it's a regular pattern in a relationship, you know, that's a recipe for long-term trouble. And the larger point here that John Gottman makes, and John Gottman is a psychologist at the University of Washington, emeritus now, who had the Love Lab back in the 80s and 90s in Seattle, where he would put couples in this apartment in downtown Seattle, and he would film them interacting. And based upon this process, he could predict with 81% accuracy, which is pretty darn impressive, whether or not they would get divorced within some time frame. But his basic insight, besides these two points, was that couples who had five positive interactions for every one negative interaction were just doing great, whereas couples who were going closer to one and one were really in trouble. So the broader point here is just, as you think about your relationship in the courtship stage, to think about is it mainly a positive one or not. And once again, this seems like kind of common sense, but I have a colleague at another university who was in a long-term relationship with someone where she was repeatedly critical towards him, negative towards him, and he's a, you know, good guy, and it took him about, you know, really probably a year to break off this relationship for a variety of reasons. But I think he should have moved much more quickly than he did, part because of this basic dynamic here.
Well, and I would just say one other thing about that, the positive to negative interactions is, I think at one point when I was working, you know, one of the boards I was on, every bad little piece of bad news or criticism to a staff member came as a praise sandwich, you know, like, oh, you've done everything great, and I just love, you know, the way the font size, but you know, your grammar is really, we're going to work on some grammar issues, but you know what, I loved the way you put the cover on, and okay, you know, so it was super positive. And then I would come home and be like, I can't believe you didn't get dinner started. You know, and you can see how it's very easy to treat the person you are almost, you know, that you're closest to worse because you're so familiar with them. So I think it's one of those things, like, to get in the really good habit of not just treating your colleagues and staff members and people who might come and go easily in your life, so you try a little harder with them, but to treat your spouse the same way, that praise sandwich. So... The next slide, though. This is you. Go ahead.
So it's also important, too, when you're thinking about courtship, is to look for commitment with your partner. And there are two things that are worth touching on. One is that your partner is committed to you as a person and to your welfare, and that your partner places you above other people and does so clearly. A second point is that your boyfriend, your girlfriend, has a commitment to marriage as a lifelong institution and doesn't see divorce as an option. The sort of shared commitment to marriage fosters a sense of trust and security and a spirit of shared sacrifice that is, they're all crucial to forming and sustaining strong marriages. And the final point here is that commitment is particularly important for men. This is once again based on the work of Scott Stanley. And he makes the point that men are much more likely to kind of do the kind of emotional work to make the kind of compromises, sacrifices they need to be good husbands if they have that deep commitment, both normatively to marriage and personally to their spouse. And that, once again, one reason why he thinks cohabitation is so harmful is you get these guys who are kind of nominally committed to a particular person and kind of drift into marriage with this person, but they never really kind of get their game going once they get married, and that can lead to real troubles.
So good woman or man is hard to find. And given the financial and practical challenges of parenting, it's vital that your partner has the capacity to grow in the following virtues. And some of the ones that we singled out were thrift, fortitude, wisdom, loyalty, and charity. And essentially it goes back to, what is this person's character? I think often, especially, you know, the younger you are, the less you're thinking about the whole time horizon, and how important it is to know, how does that person handle adversity in terms of loyalty, for example? You know, these are typically not the questions you're asking yourself. At least this is based on my vague, dim recollections of college, and also just for the many babysitters who trip through our house. You know, one of the things we hear is just, oh, he's so handsome, or he did this for me, and you know, it's all very in the present, but rather than looking a little more deeply at, will this person be a good husband, a good father, will she be a good wife, a good mother? And some of the ways to know that, just thinking of loyalty, for example, is, I mean, how do you know that? Well, how does that person treat their friends and family? I had a college hallmate, I guess, in my dorm who I should have been tipped off, but she had a habit of telling all these stories from high school, like, oh, my old best friend so-and-so and I did this, and then my old best friend Nancy and I did this, and I thought, that's a lot of old best friends. And you can imagine by second year, I was an old best friend. But it gives you a clue that this person probably had some difficulty forming deep friendships that would last. So looking at the person you're courting or who is courting you, and asking yourself, what is, you know, how do they treat their friends? How do they treat their family? What's the nature of their conversation? You know, is it positive mostly, or is it a lot of complaining? How do they spend their money? Just going back to thrift. So these are some of the questions, definitely, when courting, to take it to the next level, thinking about, not just am I happy now, but how is this person going to be as fulfilling that role of father and husband, or wife and mother?
Two points to make here on the friends and family front. The one basic point is that you should really sort of, you know, the older courtship systems basically had sort of structured ways where people could get input from their friends and family about a potential spouse. We don't have that anymore. So what we're basically encouraging you to do is to, I'm not necessarily to be sort of artificial, but just basically try to get the sense of how do the friends and family members that you trust, how do they look at someone that you're dating, that you're courting? And if they give that person thumbs up, that's probably a good sign. If they don't, that's something worth thinking about. And just on the issue of family background, it's just worth noting that people who come from divorced homes are more likely themselves to get divorced. And what the literature suggests is that, you know, that risk is reduced when you have at least, you know, one spouse coming from an intact family. So, you know, if you do come from a divorced home, you know, I would encourage you to try to find someone who comes from an intact family who's kind of got a, you know, good template, you know, in their head as to how to negotiate family life But not to have two kids from divorced homes marry, that's a very risky pattern, judging by the literature.
Well, there is one story that's very complimentary to Brad, which is that, speaking of friends and family, as I said, I kind of mentioned we muddled through our courtship, and during a year of it at least, we were just good friends. We were both overlapped and were working in D.C., and I had just moved back from Seattle, having dated some moody artist that my parents were highly, highly alarmed by. And they had already met Brad and decided he fit the all the qualities of virtue that I had just discussed. I mean, he was, you've never met a more steady Eddie. So, you know, my parents were like, I don't think I even had insurance, health insurance at the time. And Brad was like, oh, health insurance, that's a must, you know. So my parents, in any case, my parents were very excited that we were overlapping in D.C. And they sent my sister to live with me for a summer, my younger sister. And she and a college friend of ours, the one who actually set us up on our first date, spent the summer plotting all these ways we could run into each other or meet up, or, you know, she would call my Brad and say, she loves vanilla lattes, like, swing by with one, you know, and he would swing by, you're grading exams, you probably need a latte. So, and he still does that. But in any case, what happened was history. We ended up, my parents' plan worked. Our friend Andrew, who set us up on that first date, spent the summer plotting with my sister, was the best man at our wedding and took full credit at the wedding for this. So that's a good example there.
We met the spring of our fourth year here at UVA. So
first date was April Fool's Day.
Yeah. Now, I could talk at length about the issue of religion, and this is not, once again, this is not rocket science here. It helps to be on the same page religiously. But what I'd like to say, beyond sort of the obvious points here, is I think it helps for couples, it helps them to basically, when they have a faith, it helps them to focus on something larger than themselves. And that, you know, particularly today, there's a soulmate marriage model out there where people are investing so much hope and so much meaning and energy and attention into a romantic relationship that, you know, they think will come to fruition in marriage. And of course, the problem with that is that no person, no relationship is capable of sustaining all those hopes and dreams. And that, by contrast, people who have a faith, I think, realize, you know, that's the truth, and they're not going to invest kind of false hopes in a marriage, and they're going to be more grounded in ways that are good for them and good for their spouse and good for their family life. So the point here simply is that I think having a faith gives you a sense of perspective, a sense of realism, and also a proper orientation of what's really important, what's going to be really your source of meaning and purpose in life, rather than, you know, than in your spouse, no matter how important she might be for you.
Right. Assuming you've negotiated courtship and are now entering marriage, we had a couple of guidelines to help with marriage. Things not to do would be to seek a 50-50 marriage, a measuring of equal inputs and outputs from both spouses. This one's fairly obvious, but you'd be surprised how many times you forget it. Don't be unfair or selfish. And then be careful about your friendships with members of the opposite sex. Things that you should do are that each spouse should be emotionally engaged with the other. The second would be to appreciate and live out complementarity within the marriage. And then to strengthen your faith together and to seek out friends who support the marriage.
So here in the Academy, there's a lot of focus on equality, on egalitarianism. And what I would like to just argue this morning is that couples who really try to sort of split things on a 50-50 basis don't do very well. And that's true for a couple of reasons. One is that keeping score in any relationship, be it a marriage, be it a business partnership, be it a good, you know, golfing buddy, friendship, whatever. I mean, well, of course, you have to be in golfing. But anyways, but I mean, sort of keeping score on a kind of on a 50-50 basis is hard work, and it's not conducive to building a good marriage. The second point, of course, is that spouses have different strengths and different interests, and it's good to build on those rather than to try to deny them. So let people kind of, you know, work in the area of the marriage and family where their natural strengths manifest themselves. And the other point, too, is that this sort of 50-50 mindset can undercut an ethic of mutual dependency. And dependency is a good thing for marriage. It's something that helps to bind spouses one to the other. So this is me, too. Now, having said that, though, I mean, I also want to be very clear here, and this is very clear in the literature, is that equity is important. A sense of fairness is important. And we know that when spouses, usually the wife, but not always, especially today, there are differences, but generally speaking, still the wife has this. When one spouse has a sense that things are not fair in their marriage, that quickly becomes grounds for conflict, for hurt feelings, and for less time spent together, and even eventually, in some cases, for divorce. And this can be particularly a problem when you have two spouses working full-time with kids in the household, because what's usually the case is that husbands don't do half the housework and half the childcare. Doesn't matter how liberal or how conservative they might be, in most marriages, husbands don't do half the housework and half the childcare. And so when you have both spouses working full-time and you add kids to the mix, that can breed a sense of clear unhappiness on the part of women. So each of you will sort of handle the work-family balance in different ways, but you need to be attentive to this issue of fairness and also to of probably sequencing things. You're not going to do everything at the same time in your life. This is true for both women and for men. You have to figure out what's going to happen now in your marriage that's, you know, good for your spouse, for your kids, and for you, and to be realistic and fair about that.
Another thing to caution against is just relationships with members of the opposite sex. I mean, sexually intimate ones, that's pretty obvious, but there's emotionally intimate ones, and I think this is there, as it says on the slide, there are a few rules that are guiding our relationships between men and women in the workplace. You socialize, travel, you share a lot. So it's easy to become intimate with that person in a way that could undercut your own marriage. And it's something to guard against. It's not that men and women can't be friends, can't be colleagues, but it is something when talking through your deepest problems that should really be reserved for your spouse, your family members, a friend of the same sex, because these are things that bond you, that kind of emotional outpouring and assistance that person would give you. And so if you're expending that on somebody else who's not your spouse, it's going to detract from that marriage, over time. And this is something, and this is actually more humorous, it wasn't, but we had to fix that. I guess it was during that fateful year that Brad and I overlapped in D.C., there was one, and I was fairly certain he was pursuing me, but without any rules of courtship or guidelines, it was really hard to know. But he invited me to dinner, and I offered to bring something, but he insisted I don't need to bring a thing. So I was so impressed. He's going to cook me dinner. I had offered salad. I'd offered wine. It's all taken care of. I get there. There are three or four other women who have been invited to the dinner, and they've provided the wine, the salad, the dessert, etc. And I think they all knew that they were just friends and everything else, but I realized, as a long-term thing, I'm not sure this is going to work, you know. So I don't recall this, but Brad recalls that shortly after we got engaged, I was very clear about all those friends would have to transfer and become my friends, and, you know, we'd be group friends. And one of them did, well, I think one of them was a bridesmaid, just one. Yeah, Denzel, yep. So you can try establishing good habits now, question yourself, but it's something definitely later in marriage, I think is really essential. to have those boundaries.
I think basically it just comes down to a question, I mean, to a question of kind of being discreet with colleagues at work of the opposite sex in terms of obviously you can be professional, decent friends, but you don't want to kind of open up to them in some kind of meaningful way, particularly when you're facing challenges in your home marriage. That's particularly when you want to steer clear of someone in the workplace who is, you know, who is of the opposite sex. So I did a study in 2006, and I was motivated in part because a lot of academics, once again, are really concerned about looking at gender issues as predictors of marital success, and I wanted to see how, like, housework, for instance, compared to emotional engagement in married life. Of course, there was no comparison whatsoever. When women were kind of asked how happy they were in marriage, and then they're also kind of sort of checking off boxes in terms of, like, you know, who does what around the house and how emotionally engaged my husband is, it was very clear that the most important predictor of women's happiness in marriage was their husband's emotional engagement, his affection, his empathy, and his understanding. So that's something to kind of bear in mind, all you guys out there, because after you get married, it's a lot more challenging to be as, you know, on the money emotionally as you were when you were courting. So you need to keep working at that once you go ahead and get married. And also, I think, too, that women need to realize that men are not women, and that they can seek some of their need for emotional support and communication and whatnot with their female friends, their mother, and their sisters. And then the other point, too, is, and this is sort of a related point, is that, you know, my view is that some appreciation for the fact that women and men are on average different in some important respects will be helpful in building a strong relationship and navigating the challenges of married life. And for us, that came out really kind of in how we dealt with challenges, but either personal or as a couple. And when we initially were kind of dealing with, you know, a challenge in our married life or a challenge personally, I think we had the expectation that we approach them in a similar fashion. And my approach to a challenge is to retreat into my study and think about it, mull over it, whether it's writing a, you know, a paper or something else, finances, whatever else it might be. Whereas Danielle's approach is different.
I like to talk about things. So I like to talk about possibilities, possible solutions. What if this worked? What if we did this? But as soon as I start saying what if, I can feel Brad's blood pressure rising.
Often involving like buying things for the house and whatnot.
All right. It does. Your blood pressure definitely goes up more when I say things like, oh, wouldn't it be great if we put some shelves in there? And I mean, instantly, let's talk later, you know. What we had to figure out is that just because I mentioned shelves doesn't mean I want to buy them tomorrow. It's like 10 years down the road, and sometimes I just like to daydream. And, you know, if we're talking about issues with our kids, what we should do about school, you know, things like that, I like to talk through all the possibilities. So what I've learned is that I have good friends with whom I can talk through these things. I talk about them with Brad also, but I usually preface it with, we're just talking. We don't have to solve it tonight. And then not bringing it up too late at night. Because I did have a bad habit of starting at, say, 10:30, 11. You know, I wonder if we changed this with, you know, this kid, we could... And that definitely set his pulse racing. So having to respect these communication differences. I would have been happy with a 10-minute discussion at 10:30 at night, and it wouldn't have stressed me out, but definitely was not working. So we had to recognize, appreciate, and also just have a sense of humor about the differences in our communication styles. So,
and just to quickly wrap things up here, I've already mentioned the idea of faith, but I want to sort of stress once again that once you get married, it's important to have a sort of a network of friends who support you as persons and support your marriage, and that often, you know, for many of us, we'll find this network of people. In a religious congregation or in some kind of religious network. People who are there for you when you need them, people who will, you know, hold you to a high standard, which is what you need at certain points in your life, and, you know, people who you can look for, you know, counsel and support throughout your married life. So just to conclude, marriage today is a daring and often almost dangerous adventure. And it's particularly challenging because we don't have institutionalized rules to guide us through courtship and even married life today. So the rules that we've offered today should give you some guidance as you think about courtship and marriage. And our sociological bottom line today is that this adventure is best undertaken in a church community that honors and values married life. And that the paradox of contemporary marriage or contemporary marital happiness is that happiness in marriage is most likely to be found by seeing marriage as an opportunity to make a gift of oneself to God, to one's spouse, and to one's children. Thank you.
We'll open it up for Q&A. So, first question. You talked about how you need to be looking for a partner with high standards in your own mind who fit all these requirements. But oftentimes, like, I see this whole presentation, I think, oh, that's something I need to work on. And a lot of times we hear that you don't want to get into a relationship thinking you have to change someone. But what are the qualities that you think are important enough that you can work on within a marriage that can still be successful but not detrimental?
That's a great question. And, you know, bear in mind the picture we began with of the doctor smoking, you know, probably, you know, outside the ER room, whenever. But so the point is that no person is going to meet all the, is going to check off all the boxes. That's human nature. But I think in terms of foundational things, two of the things they'll be looking for are those commitment things, like, you know, commitment to you as a person, commitment to marriage as an institution. And then I think thinking about the virtues and thinking, too, about being married with kids. And, you know, when you've got a sick baby, as we had last night, you know, is this person going to be really helpful? And is this person going to be someone you can really rely upon? Is this person going to be a hard worker and make enough money to keep, you know, as the float kind of thing. So you have to kind of think about what are really the fundamentally important things for you as a person, but also as a future spouse and mother too, I would say.
Yeah, I would agree with Brad. I would definitely say commitment, that some demonstrated record of stability, and by that I just mean a capacity for close lasting friendships, a demonstrated record of sacrifice. And I'm not saying someone's going to be perfect. Like, they're always going to offer you the last piece of, you know, food or whatever. But someone who, they're considerate, they're will. You've seen them at times able to sacrifice their own personal happiness or their comfort for other people, because that's going to really come in handy throughout marriage. A lot of these things too, though, I think. Also, just someone who has a good sense of self-awareness. And I think you've probably met lots of people who are completely clueless about the many faults that you can see. But, you know, someone who is able to see some of their own faults, because, like you said, you can't really change the person. They have to want to change some of these things themselves. So when I read off the list of all those things, I'm thinking, whew, thrift, fortitude, I don't know. You know, all these are things that, of course, we still need to work on, but I think it's at least a first good step that I realize I need to work on these things, and that you, as you're listening to the talk, realize you need to work on these things. So,
I think too, just to follow up, there is this idea you can't change your spouse, you know. I think spouses in good marriages do change one another. but there's a certain kind of, there's a grace to it. There's a certain kind of, you know, you're not like hectoring someone. You're not whatever, you know, you're just, there's just, it's, it happens kind of organically to some degree. But also there's a community dimension here. And it's not just about you and this other person. It's about you guys are embedded in a community where, you know, say this guy is going to be getting advice and counsel from his friends about, you know what, you need to do this better. Or, you know, you're not doing this particularly well. And he's going to be able actually to change his behavior or whatever his approach to something based upon their input probably much easier than based upon your criticism. So think, too, about is this person embedded in a community where he's going to get that reinforcement in ways that are helpful to a marriage.
Wherever the microphone is. You said one your first thing about the ages at which you thought it was good to get married, and then two, the not wanting to marry someone who came from, like, a divorce background. I mean, to some extent, these are things that people can't necessarily control. So, I mean, part of your talk, like, saying, oh, people are happier if they get married between 23 to 28. So as someone's, you know, approaching their 26th birthday, do they just say, you, like, I mean...
No, obviously not.
And, like, like, I mean, to what extent is this, like, overly quantifying human...
No, it's a good point. The point simply is that, I mean, in the world that I work and live in, the basic idea is that you should postpone marriage until your early 30s. That's kind of that's the new norm. And because then you can do everything else that you need to do to get all your ducks in a row in terms of your, you know, professional degree, da da da. And what I'm saying is that, you know, from an empirical perspective, it looks like, on average, for the average person in America, getting married in their mid-20s is a good time to do it, you know, and for the reasons that I articulated. But, you know, there are going to be people who get married younger and later and do perfectly well. And, of course, it's based upon not just the age at marriage, but also the other kinds of things that we're talking about. And particularly for folks who get married younger than their mid-20s, being embedded in a community, religious community, is going to be crucial for them in terms of helping to navigate the challenges of being married young. But... it's just one factor among many, and oftentimes people can't control it. And of course, you shouldn't just get married because you're 27, you're approaching that 28 window. But what I would encourage people to do is to be more intentional about marriage when they're in college and when they're in their early 20s. And be thinking about, well, is this person that I've gotten to know or heard about, does he have or does she have the qualities that might be, you know, worthy of consideration for marriage? And what was the second part of your? No, that's true, but I'm just saying that let me put it this way. I think if you do come from a divorced home, you need to be aware of the fact that it is a risk factor, and that what we see in the literature is it's particularly risky when you marry someone who also comes from a divorced home. So I'm saying, other things being equal, if you come from a divorced home, I would encourage you to try to find someone who comes from a stable home and who basically has access, both kind of practically and sort of symbolically, to kind of knowing what a sort of a stable family life looks like. Because at least empirically, we know that your chances of succeeding in marriage are much higher if you marry someone from an intact family than if you marry another young adult who has come from a divorced home.
You mentioned that you have 7 children, and I was wondering whether you could discuss the element of children within marriage, especially because in our culture today, there's a very viable option of contraception, which tends to take children completely out of the picture in sexual relationships in general, but also in marriage.
Well, I think especially, this is something that has to be considered, obviously, by both men and women. But I think for women in particular, there's a tendency not to think about how much children will affect your future career possibilities and your marriage. In fact, when I was at UVA during Women's History Month, the Women's Center hosted, I don't know if they still do this, but it was like an event every single night. And it was like date rape, finding your gender identity. There was nothing that dealt with marriage and family, and just, or like combining women, you know, motherhood and career, which in many ways, all those other issues might be important to talk about, but that is the condition that almost every woman is going to have to think through, is how are you going to do this? So I guess to answer your question, it's something I think, as you're considering marriage, it should be part of, you know, one and the same with thinking about the spouse as a husband or a wife, but also thinking about them as a wife, as a father and a mother. I don't think Brad and I ever expected to have 8 children, but here we are with 8 children, and it does require lots of sacrifice. You know, I worked through the first 3 children, but then we adopted 4 and 5, and it was impossible. So being able to make that decision, knowing what your spouse is capable of in terms of negotiating schedules if you want to try and combine work and family, and then also just being willing to make sacrifices along the way that will accommodate the children that do come.
I think too, what I've seen among some of the young women that I've sort of taught and watched after UVA is there's kind of a transition from being here at UVA with kind of the one mindset about work and family, and then they get married and have kids, and then they realize that their kids are enormously meaningful to them. And the work is not as meaningful as I thought it might be. Not that they don't want to have some kind of professional identity, but just that when kids are in the picture, their focus moves more in the direction of their children. So I think in terms of one of the things for people here to think about is just, you know, how does what you're doing today affect not just your future in terms of professional life and married life, but also your capacity to be a good mother, a good father. Now, in terms of, to sort of answer your question more broadly, I think when we first got married, I realized there was a lot of ways in which I was profoundly selfish, and I had to make a lot of changes as a husband. And I think that sort of insight is deepened exponentially when you become a parent. It really is a challenge being a parent, obviously. It requires a lot of sacrifice. And a lot of growth and virtue, but of course the upside is some really great kids and an enormously meaningful way of life.
I was wondering if you could discuss more on the idea of with the opposite sex, like intimateness, because I have a lot of female friends that I'm very close with because, you know, they're great support for spiritual and just really good friends. But I also have a girlfriend. And I don't, you know, consider, like, the way I treat them is different, obviously. But the way you made it seem like kind of like forcing everyone to become friends, because I know that can't always happen. How would you take a situation like that and sort of deal with that in a marriage?
That is a challenge. And I don't think you can't force a friendship. So when I was talking about that, I think I became friendly with everyone, but note, only one of them became a bridesmaid. We became true, really good friends. But I do think, I think 2 things. One, it's a different status in life. You have a girlfriend. She's not your wife. I do think this is the place to practice good habits that will help you when you are married, because I think a marriage, it's fundamentally different. You just, right now, everything maybe is bliss with you and your girlfriend, and it's hard to imagine how having these female friends could pose any kind of threat or to you or to these other women. But in marriage, there are highs, there are lows, and these friendships can be you know, a real distraction or detraction from the marriage. And, you know, I don't think you want to be good friends with a woman, too, that your wife can't stand, or who you know, maybe so that friendship might have to cool. I think you have to be able willing to, you know, maybe there's something going on with your wife too, and you talk it through with her. But your primary focus is trying to figure out how you and your wife can keep your union strong and intact, and that might mean sacrificing some friends at times. I guess the other thing I'd say though about having lots of friends who are girls, even when you have, you know, this blissful relationship with your girlfriend, is just keeping in mind that both, you know, before you're married and when you're married, all those people you're friends with, if there is, even if you might not feel an emotional intimacy with them, they might. And it kind of prevents them from being on the path towards their future spouse. So it's just, it's a caution that goes with faith. There's no perfect formula. I wouldn't say, you know, you could be friends with girls, but only talk to them between the hours of like noon and three. Those are like safe hours, you know. But, you know, I think there are some wise things you can do about these friendships to keep them a little bit at a distance. And I would say it matters more and more the closer you are towards marriage and married.
And practically, you know, too, once you're married and have kids, you just don't have much time. And so you don't have time to be, you know, cultivating these female friendships on the side. And you, it's probably good for you to have a few good male friends that you can, you know, sustain, you know, as a husband and father. And you have to devote a lot of time to your wife and to your kids. So part of it, she's thinking about, you know, down the road, it's just not, you know, you're kind of at a unique stage in your life in that regard. So.
We've been talking a lot about what to look for in other people. And somewhere I heard something really wise. I thought that healthy individuals make healthy choices and healthy marriages. And I just wanted your perspective on what to do to focus on making sure that we fix all our, I don't know, some of us may be lucky and have perfect childhoods and be completely perfect and meet all these criteria that we're looking for in other people, but just get your perspective and advice on how to cultivate all this stuff and make ourselves like as healthy individuals as possible while we're pursuing or while we're even waiting to find our spouses.
Yeah, that's a big question. you know, I don't think we have any kind of, you know, magic bullet, you know, for that kind of question. I think it would just come back to, you know, I don't want to be a one-note Johnny here, but I think if you are engaged in a religious community and, you know, you're serious about that in terms of just accountability, people, you know, are in your lives and helping you grow as a person. We know that prayer creates an opportunity for people to be reflexive about what they're doing in their lives and how they're doing it, what their behavior is like, is good or bad. So that would be certainly one thing that I would say in terms of how to work on strengthening yourself as a person. And then, of course, in doing that, you become a more attractive potential spouse down the road as well. So, yes, over here.
Hi. I wanted you to follow up the question that the gentleman down there asked about other women that are his friends. I think the challenge that these group of students have and young professionals is that they have Facebook, they have social networks. And I think that that would be very difficult to navigate because, as you know, in marriage, you really have to work on being one unit. You know, you go from two to one. And I think you almost have to be very strategic and very deliberate of making a decision that maybe you go to one Facebook site, you know, and really view it that way. Because I think it is very tempting in marriage, if you have a bad argument, to retreat to the computer, and maybe there's an old girlfriend or an old boyfriend, and they can come to the rescue, and it may look very, you know, helpful. But I think it is a temptation. I'd like for you to talk about that, because I think that's a reality that these students are going to have to face.
Yeah, I think we're just beginning to sort of understand the way in which the internet is affecting married life. And I certainly, anecdotally, you know that people are reconnecting with old flames on the internet, or even actually going to high school reunions. Danielle's friend actually has had that experience of kind of, you know, seeing one of her old boyfriends and, you know, so. But that sort of reality is much more present given the electronic environment that we're living in today. So I think it is. It's just, once again, the same idea of trying to have some degree of discretion, some degree of boundaries that you apply to yourself, and that includes on the internet. Because if you don't, there are opportunities for, you know, connection, intimacy, et cetera, that can quickly lead downhill.
Yeah, I'm not sure I have anything to add to about rules regarding how often you should check Facebook or not. But I think your larger point is really important, which is that if you want to have a good marriage, I don't think you can take your cues from what everyone else is doing. But you have to actually be very deliberate about safeguarding your marriage. And I don't mean to sound like a jailer, you know, Brad's allowed, I let him out for this talk. But that you do have to be very deliberate about your contacts with friends. Your Facebook is one example. But prior to Facebook, people had lots of opportunities to still cultivate relationships that might have hurt their own marriage. And Facebook is just now another tool, and a very convenient tool, because high school reunions only happen, what, every 5, 10, 15 years? Facebook is free. I mean, it's available to you 24/7. So, but just, I think your point is really good, just that it has, that to have a good marriage requires being very deliberate and thoughtful about your marriage. On that note, I am going to leave. I have to meet a babysitter with 7 children in a car in a roundabout outside the building. So you can continue your questions, but thank you so much for letting me be here.
A common thread that I seem to notice throughout your presentation would be faith. To what extent do you think your rules would change in a situation where there either is no common faith between the two partners or no faith for either of them?
Well, the rules would be pretty much, pretty much the same. It's just that I think sort of the sort of more fundamental orientation, I think, becomes obviously somewhat different. I think for people who don't share the same faith, or who don't have, you know, faith, I think it's important to see marriage as an institution that embodies a variety of goods, the goods of friendship, the goods of economic cooperation, the goods of sort of mutual assistance, and most fundamentally the goods of, you know, of raising children together, and to have that kind of rich conception of married life that they can share together as a couple, as well as some other interests and values that they share as a couple. Just given the nature of our contemporary society, there are going to be people here who are marrying someone outside the faith, or marrying someone of no faith, or whatever else it might be. So I think for people who end up in that situation, the thing that I would say you need to look for is does this person have a kind of commitment to marriage as an institution and appreciation for all that married life is, and the capacity to make sacrifices and to live the virtues in ways that will be good for them as a spouse and as a parent. So, yes, Lucy.
You say that when in a courtship, you're trying to discern long-term compatibility. You should look for, you know, shared commitment to marriage and family and common faith, and those things all seem very essential and, you know, kind of obvious in a way. But what about compatibility in other less obvious areas? I heard one quote said something about, like, make sure the person you marry, you have good conversation with them, because they're the person you're going to be talking to for the next 60 years. if you have other passions outside those essential things, you know, such as what you're studying, things like that, and your partner is just not interested in them in the same extent, and you kind of feel like that falls flat, how necessary versus unnecessary? Do you think that has to be? Obviously, you're not going to find someone you're totally compatible with, but I just wondered if you could speak on that a bit.
I know plenty of married folks who have some common interests, but then plenty of divergent interests, you know, so I don't think it's, you're never going to find a perfect match, and that might actually be kind of, you know, boring to have someone where you're completely compatible. So it's more that you, it's, you know, there's no firm rule here, but just the point would be that there should be some things that you enjoy doing together and considering together, and that universe could be 4, 5, 6, or 12. But, you know, that there's sort of a set of things you like to do together and a set of commitments that you have, whether it's the environment, faith, whatever it might be, that you share would be the basis for a friendship. So it doesn't necessarily have to be the same common academic interest, for instance, but there's a set of things that you do together that you can talk about together that would sustain you over the long term. But too, I mean, recognizing that in any kind of relationship, there are going to be moments that are awkward, difficult. There are going to be periods of silence, you know, all that kind of stuff. That's very natural, and that shouldn't be a cause for concern. But the more fundamental question is, do you have enough in common to sustain a strong marital friendship? But and that's based upon your judgment.
I guess to follow up on some of the last few questions that have been asked, one of the ways that people in common culture seek to ensure that they find somebody that they're compatible with is through these internet dating sites like eyarmy.com. Is there anything in the literature that talks about how the internet affects relationships and whether the first encounter is necessary to be in person or something like that?
That's a great question. And I have to say that I was initially pretty skeptical of eHarmony and other internet dating services. But I have to, I mean, sort of in watching friends sort of navigate this, people, you know, in their 20s and 30s navigate this issue of finding a spouse, people who wanted to get married, who were very kind of deliberate about that and just hadn't had success for one reason or another. I mean, certainly, I think that some of the sites are much better places to meet a future spouse than a bar, for instance, you know. And especially some of the specific Catholic, Jewish, evangelical sites in eHarmony are pretty intentional about looking at, you know, these common interests and commitments, too. And then matching people on that basis. So, I mean, I would say my first preference is to meet someone in the flesh, oftentimes through things like, you know, classes or activities at college or things at work, or because you, even better, you've got a friend who knows someone who thinks would be good for you. That's kind of the ideal way to meet someone. But if that doesn't work out, then I have no objection to internet services, as long as you're kind of, once again, taking into account the importance of the kinds of things we've talked about, you know, this morning. So.
Hey there. So you talked about how it is important not to keep score, as you put it. But it also seems very clearly the case that there exists certain typical abusive relationships where there are very strong warning signs, very large red flags. And the thought process would be that if people were better at identifying these things, that they could get out what they still could. So how would you balance the notion of this kind of petty bean counting with the other side of watching out for those important red flags?
Well, I mean, I think the point here, of course, is there some people are fundamentally selfish or narcissistic, and they don't make very good spouses. And I think the challenge, though, is that when people are dating or courting, they're putting their best foot forward, and they can kind of, you know, mask or to some degree, keep down that side of themselves. But if you look at their friends, or if your friends get into a relationship with that person, they often are able to see that better than you are if you're dating that person. So what I would say in terms of the courtship phase is it's helpful to think about the kinds of friends this person has, and also what do your friends and what do your family members think about this person. I mean, in terms of people you would, you know, who you trust and have a good judgment, can help you get some kind of purchase on that reality. I mean, there are no perfect guarantees in life, but I think, you know, you often can get some insight into someone's character from, you know, getting a sense of their friends and from having your friends get to know that person as well. But, you know, once you're married, it is the case that people have different times when they've got, you know, more energy, less energy, when they're more helpful around the house and they're less helpful around the house. That's going to kind of ebb and flow to some extent. I'm not saying you shouldn't, you know, try to do things in a fair basis. I think that fairness is important. But just to realize it's gonna you know, vary from day to day to some extent in any normal marriage. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Let's see. Two kind of connected comments. One thing, I think there's definitely a stereotype. This is partly related to Dr. Rhodes' presentation, but there's the stereotype out there that men are more sexually driven, which is obviously true, and it's important to know. But also, men want emotional closeness. I think it's important we try to convey, reassure you guys that, you know, you also want the same thing. You go about it in a different way, but you want the same thing. And with that, I think it's helpful to know that we don't have the skills. We don't know how to listen to each other. And I just wonder if you have any statistics on, you know, marriage education courses and, you know, building skills so that we can finally meet.
Well, I sort of look at it, I'm not sure, Steve and I might have a different percentage, you know, here. In terms of men, women, you know, things like sex versus cuddling, or, you know, I was talking about this in class last week or this past week, but, you know, so for instance, that what the literature both actually on human beings and mammals suggests that females are more like, you know, the grooming, you know, the cuddling is valuable in some ways more so. Men, it's more the sex, and, you know, women, it's more sort of the face-to-face stuff, you know, the emotional, I love you, you know, thank you, blah, blah, blah. Whereas guys, more shoulder-to-shoulder stuff, doing things together as guys. But I look at it more like kind of a 60-40 basis, where guys kind of are, you know, somewhat more oriented towards sex and, you know, and sort of that activity together. And women are somewhat more oriented towards, you know, the close physical, you know, hugging and cuddling and that one-on-one interaction in a relationship. But that both sexes have a need for these things, and they tend to do well when they get all these things in one package, which is what marriage, you know, should be doing. And I think one way to do that is to get sorry, colon. One way to do that is to get some good pre-marriage preparation or some good marriage skills training. And then I think also too, but just in our day and age, this goes back to the question about kind of Facebook, it's important for everyone to take their Blackberries, whatever else they have, and just, you know, put them away for, you know, periods of time in the evening or on the weekends, and turn off the computer and turn off the TV and turn off everything. And that's, I think, really important for sustaining a strong marriage and a good family life too.
Would you mind just briefly mentioning something about triangulation in terms of like going to other people to talk about things?
Sure. I mean, we actually, in my class, I had two women come in on Monday to talk about their experience with marriage and family life. And one of the women made the point that she never raises concerns that she has with her husband. I mean, his, you know, whatever his behavior, his attitude, his mentality, whatever, with her female friends. And that she has other friends that she knows who kind of will publicly sort of disrespect their spouses with their friends. And, you know, she made the point that she thinks that, you know, the only person who can really change your spouse is your spouse. And that, so you shouldn't be, you know, sharing concerns with friends, not to mention acquaintances, about your spouse. I think that's, you know, that's basically true. What I would say though is that you know, good, really good friends, and, you know, potentially a religious leader or a psychologist, whatever, you know, if you've got a real concern, you know, a fundamental concern about something that your spouse is doing, or maybe it's alcohol abuse, or maybe it's a friendship with someone of the opposite sex that seems like it's going in the wrong direction. In that case, I think you could legitimately approach someone who seemed like a wise person and get their advice. But I think willy-nilly, you shouldn't be sharing any kind of concern you have or complaining about your spouse to people outside the marriage. So.